long journey to Hapai starts with an afternoon bus journey into town. I'll be travelling with Friendly Island Shipping Agency, one of two companies offering long-distance boat travel in Tonga. Hello everybody from Tonga. So I am just about to depart on my second adventure in Tonga. Call me crazy, and you might be right in a few days when I can't get back here, but I'm about to get on a ferry to an island called Hapai, or rather an island group called Hapai. So it's a lot busier here than when I took the ferry to Awa. So only a couple of days ago, or a few days ago, I ventured out of the island of Tongatapu to head to Awa. Now, Awa is only about 2 or 3 hours away on the ferry, and actually it's still part of the same island group as Tongatapu. It's actually called the Tongatapu Island Group. But where I'm about to head is Hapai. It's part of a new island group in Tonga, the Hapai Island Group. And it's apparently a 12-hour ferry away. I hope that it just stays at 12 hours and doesn't get any more than that, because I don't know if I want to stay any longer on this ferry that I've just seen in front of me. So it's 5 p.m. here, and boarding time is at 5, and it's 6 o'clock, it's due to leave. So there's massive crowds. I'm going to go ahead and try and get a good seat where I'm going to spend the night, and hopefully arrive on Hapai early in the morning to start my brief few day adventure. Hopefully it just stays at that and doesn't get any more than a few days, and I don't get stuck there and even further stranded. You can see behind me, it's getting very, very busy. When I went to Awa, there was like no one here, so it's quite intense. Lots and lots of people need to find a good place on the ferry. I'm starting to think it might be difficult to get a good place on the boat. So I'm currently, I just got aboard the ship that will hopefully take me to Hapai and back. It's absolutely mental. It's like a maze. Like, I tried to get on as quick as possible to find like the best place, but there's like so many different rooms and so many things going on, everyone like kind of sitting everywhere. So currently just kind of walking around the ship. I've hit a bit of a dead end right at the front of the ship. I'm just currently kind of walking around seeing if there's any better I could have done, but I found myself a little spot in a room that hopefully I can find again, and left some stuff with some Tongans to mind. This is just mental, like trying to find a good spot to sit on when there are people just on the floor of the deck, just packing, setting out their stuff for the night. And I mean, like, everywhere's open as well. Like, just about to walk down there. Hopefully I can find it back to the original room that I put my stuff in. Oh, I found another room. Okay, this one's completely empty and very well air conditioned. There's a couple of people. Seems to be some kind of like seating areas and stuff, and a TV. I guess it's a long ride, to be fair. I think there's maybe 3 or 4 decks to this place, but honestly, like, it's just really good fun walking around and trying to find a few like spots and areas and stuff. So you can see behind me a lot of people setting up for the night. I don't know if I'm very very well prepared for this. I've got pretty much like a towel to sleep on, but I'm gonna try and make it back to where I left all my stuff. Okay, so after a bit of a stressful scrap to get a good place on the boat, I've managed to find a little spot to sleep tonight. This boat is crazy. As I'm walking around it before, you can see like there's rooms everywhere and stuff. Anyway, very cool. And right now I've just come out and just enjoying the sunset. So this ride will take about 12 hours, and actually this ferry goes all the way up to Babao, which are islands. It's an island group in the very, very north of Tonga. I'm not going all that way. It takes 20 minutes. way to Hapai, the Hapai Island group, staying a couple of days. I'm actually taking the same ferry back. So this ferry goes all the way up to Babao, gets to Babao, comes back to Hapai, and at which point I'm going to try and get on it again and then come back to Nuku'alofa. So I'm only going to be in Hapai for a couple of days. That's all I dare to go away for at the moment. I don't want to get stranded even further, but it's a really cool ship. The seas are pretty calm at the moment, as you can see. I get a little bit seasick, so I'm just really praying that that doesn't come on. But so far, so good. I'm going to head in a minute and have some of the food that I packed and then kind of chill out, have a little bit of a sleep. Actually, there's air conditioning on here and everything. I couldn't really ask for more. And this killer sunset in the background as well definitely makes the experience a little bit better. So hopefully I'll clock in with you guys in another 12 hours or so when I am arriving and the sun is rising after I've had a hopefully good night's sleep. The place that I found seems like a pretty chilled out place. There are a few kids around and stuff, a few families. People are just sleeping everywhere and gathering everywhere in the corridors and stuff. I managed to find a little quiet corner in one of the air conditioned rooms. So let's see how my night's sleep goes. And yeah, I'll speak to you guys tomorrow morning. I'm gonna go and enjoy this sunset a little bit.
I awoke at 5:30 a.m. after not really sleeping, but this sunrise made it all worth it. Hours later, and finally Pangai, the main island of Hapai, was in sight.
Okay, so finally got off that ferry. It ended up taking 14 hours. It was a very interesting 14 hours, not a kind of 14 hours that I'd like to repeat in my life. But anyway, I am on Hapai. I've arrived here safely, almost in one piece, and I'm gonna go ahead to the guest house that I am staying in and maybe have a little nap before I start exploring a little bit more.
Just a 2-minute drive and I arrive at my accommodation, a place called Evoloni Guest House, which is more like a homestay. Inside it looks like a typical Tongan house, lots of open spaces with lots of colour.
So this road that we're walking along now is actually the main road in Pangai, which is the island that I'm staying on. And actually not just the main road in Pangai, but also it connects different islands together. And it's not just the main road for another reason. It's pretty much the only road. So this road goes straight down the coast, north to south through, I think, 2, maybe 3 different islands. And yeah, it's basically the road that you want. Every other road leads off into little villages or little side roads. This road apparently has, we've got the wharf one side of me here, just behind me where I just arrived, and behind me we have a fire station, and there's also people that live here apparently. So for those that want to get off the beaten path, the real beaten path, and have trodden the routes of Southeast Asia enough, I cannot recommend the South Pacific more. Even Fiji, a country we've all heard of, really surprised me when it came to the lack of infrastructure and really lack of tourism, lack of foreigners, honestly. The other islands in the South Pacific, in Polynesia and Melanesia, are a different story. The least visited islands. There is little to no tourist infrastructure. Tonga actually has a lot of tourists every year because of the whales, but otherwise there's very few tourists that come here. And one of the funny things I find is the stuff that you find, or rather don't, online, it's all very real and raw here. If you want to find out anything, if you want to go anywhere, then you just have to do it. If you want to buy a ferry ticket, you don't book it online. You have to go to 3 different ferry ports before you find the right one to find out the timetable. And then you go home and then you realize that the information they gave you was wrong, and then you go again and then you go to a different port to buy it and then a different one to take it. It's very tiring sometimes. It's very funny. And one thing as well, when you look online, there's really so little information. A lot of countries are bogged down with the amount of blogs that people write about them. But on Tonga, I'm like yearning for more. But it's amusing what Lonely Planet write about these countries and how much they get it wrong sometimes. I've written a blog about what Lonely Planet says about the Solomon Islands. The main number one thing to do is go to the market. I won't talk about that here, but number one Lonely Planet's recommendation in Hapai is to go to a cafe. So anyway, I went there because I read somewhere that they did bike rentals. So I went there and it was closed, but we'll see what it's like later if it's open. But yeah, otherwise, I'll try and find another way of getting around, maybe some hitchhiking. We are currently walking down a very typical road in Tonga, a very typical, I don't know, residential area. So I thought I'd let you know a little bit about the villages and the houses in Tonga. So basically, actually everybody gets a piece of land in Tonga. So every family has their own piece of land, and this goes to the eldest son in the family. And they get, I think it's 5 or 7 acres or something like that. And Tonga is made up of, well, each island is made up of different villages, very small villages, and usually has one main city center. Every single village will have a church. You can see this one just behind me. And the church, like many South Pacific countries, they're usually the most grand thing in the village. The houses themselves are all very individual, but generally one-story bungalow houses with quite a bit of garden on the front or the back. A lot of families have pigs, have dogs. There's potentially more pigs and dogs here than humans. And a lot of chickens running around as well, and they'll do a lot of their own stuff. So it's quite self-sustainable. They grow their own fruit and veg a lot of the time, and then go fishing or pick up local stuff from the fish market, and then live off the pigs and chickens from their house and their eggs. And actually they do eat dog here as well. So the dogs are not just pets and are not just there to keep the house safe. Although that is definitely a feature of what they do. Barking at me all the time and coming to attack me is something that they're very good at. So the dogs have multiple purposes here. And there's usually a school or two in each village as well. And we're just about to walk past one of the schools here. So each family will generally, because it's usually a family house, they'll generally all live together or move out, but they won't move far. Usually they'll stay around their own village or near their family's house, or indeed stay in the family house. And each family, I don't know what the average is, but I would say from speaking to people, they have around 8 kids. And the kids, they help out a lot around the house. So that's how it's seen in Tongan culture. You know, the more kids you have, the more help around the house you have. And a lot of the kids go abroad to Australia and New Zealand as well and earn money and send it back. So families have big houses here because because it's practical. So just to the right hand side of me, we see what is called the European Cemetery. And now it didn't strike me as odd at all until I then was reminded about what a traditional Tongan cemetery looks like. And that is just over the road behind me here. Lots of bright colors, something that we might think of as a little bit tacky, but the stark contrast between these two is crazy. And I guess the European cemetery is from the 1800s and 1900s, and it looks very, looks like something you'd see out of, I don't know, like a ghost film and stuff. I wouldn't like to walk around here at night, but the Tongan one, on the other hand, looks very bright and colorful. I was just trying to hike up the island and I found this little beach. I thought I'd come check it out. And I find it quite cool because at the end here, let me get my finger in, at the end right here is the tip of the island. And then if we look around, we can see the other tip of the island right here. So that one behind it is a different island, but that's the tip of the island. So there we go. That's a pretty small island. After walking around for about an hour to try and find a bicycle to rent, seems like they're all broken and damaged at the moment. So I am currently sitting here trying to hitchhike up to the northern side of the island, actually onto a separate island, to a place called Sandy Beach Resort. It's one of the most popular places to hang out, and I think that I'll have more luck up there, potentially hiring a bike. It's about 14k away, so I could cycle back, and also getting some information, tourist information and stuff. Hitchhiking so far took me as far as the airport, which is kind of fun because I realized that the road is the runway. Right at the northern tip of Foa Island is where you'll find the best area for kite surfing and snorkeling. Making my way back down to Pangai, I crossed the Foa Causeway. This is a road connecting Foa Island and Pangai Island. It was renovated in 2013 with aid from the German government. The previous one used to get buried underwater at high tide. My cycle from the northernmost tip of Foa Island down to the southern end of Pangai Island has me go through small villages, fields, and roads lined with palm trees. What a incredible first day in Hapai. This island is very, very different from Eoa and from Tongatapu. And it's different in two different ways. So Eoa is very different because there are lots of hills and rainforest and heights, really, really big hills. Tongatapu is incredibly flat, and it's kind of busy, right? It's got like a city vibe. It's got the capital city. It's the main island. And this island, we're in a whole set of new island groups and 12 hours away. Actually, there's 62 island groups, islands here in this one Hapai island group. And we're a long way from Tongatapu at the moment. Actually, Hapai is right in the middle. It's like the middle island group. So it's right in the middle, and then more north you have Vavau. And Vavau is another 12 hours away. And even further, you've got the Nuas. And they're like, you know, probably about 2 days away. And then just beneath Hapai, you have Tongatapu. So Hapai sits right in the middle between Vavau in the north and Tongatapu in the south. So this morning on the ferry, I arrived at Pangai, which is the main port of call here. It's the main island. And from there, you can go to many different islands. And this is attached to another island by one very thin strip of road. And actually, I cycled the whole length of both of these islands today, from north to south. And it took an hour when I was riding super easy, accidentally almost running over goats and pigs and sheep and startling cows and things like that. So that can give you an idea about the size of the island. And it is just one road that runs through all of that. From north to south, south to north, there's just one road. There's a really amazing bit connecting the two islands. Which is a beautiful to cycle on. But yeah, those two islands together, it's just an hour's cycle. But all in all, a really fabulous first day in Hapai. So as the sun is setting right in front of me to form a gorgeous sunset, I best get back to my guest house that I'm staying in about 20 minutes away from here on this new gorgeous bike that I managed to find a place to rent out from. So, best start get going back. My second day in Hapai is a sunny one, and I decide to do some exploring into the historical and cultural spots around the island. Hello everybody, and welcome to a second day on Eoa Island. So this is my second day on Eoa Island and my one and only full day, so I will be taking the ferry back to Tongatapu tomorrow. I can't say I'm looking forward to it. I've enjoyed my time on Hapai so far, and I'm also dreading that ferry. So yesterday I cycled between two islands, the full length of two islands actually. I checked later on, it ended up being without the different routes that I took. If I had just gone down one straight road, I think it's about 15 kilometers. But I went around some different places, ended up taking me about an hour to cycle the two islands. But today I'm just going to stay on Pangai, which is the main island, and I'm going to go on a bit of a historical and culture trip around this island and you guys with me. So that will take me from right at the bottom of the island, the southern tip, all the way to the northern tip where the airport is and where the other island starts. And as I mentioned as well, it's a little bit difficult to find information on tourism activities and historical things to look out for in Tonga, purely because there's just not that much resources put into it and into the tourism. The main thing is just the whales here, and people seem to forget the rest, but I'm sure that there's a lot more than just the whales who have yet to make an appearance yet. So I'm gonna have a bit of a cycle around. The main way to kind of find these places and find these areas is just by looking and kind of following signs. So no Google Maps. Google Maps is not a help anyway. So I'm just gonna have a cycle around and see what I can find on Pangai. One of the big problems with kind of just winging it and following the signs is number one, there's an extreme lack of signs, and number two, you often feel like you're on the wrong path, and this feeling is usually right. But I think I found our first stop of today. Just look in front of me, it is the Velata Fortress. Found it! For a place quite clearly rarely visited by locals and tourists alike, this place actually plays a pretty important role in history and actually the birth of modern day Tonga as we know it today. My second stop of the day takes me to the Port-au-Prince Memorial, which has a pretty interesting history. So our next stop in Pangai takes us to an actually pretty interesting beach, not just famous for its beautiful white sands, but actually on December 1st, 1806, a British ship with 15 passengers in, it was attacked by natives here, and they killed all of the crew members of the ship. I think there was 15 crew members. They killed all of them apart from five. There were five survivors, and one of these survivors, a guy called Mariner, he was a 15-year-old boy, and he was taken in by, I guess, the head of this tribe. He was taken in and then brought up in Tonga for a few years before he was then allowed to return home back to England, where he lived, but then unfortunately drowned in a lake a few years later, I think about 30 years later. So that was here, all happened right here on this beach. A little bit of interesting British history. And the reason why this place is called Port-au-Prince Monument, and I don't know the name of this beach, I don't know if it has a name, but that was the name of the ship that the British came in on. I think they were traders, but the ship was called Port-au-Prince. That's why we have the Port-au-Prince Memorial here.
They say the spiders here are not poisonous. Doesn't make them any less scary though, especially when they hang right above you.
So the last stop on our little morning history and culture tour of Pangai in Tonga is part of maybe Tonga's modern history, shall we say. It's actually my favorite little thing on this island, and all it is a road that connects two islands. It's a little bit genius. I hope they do it with some more islands that are close by. It connects families, friends. I think it's a really cool idea. And actually this road that you're looking at right now is a new road, because the road before this used to be too low down. So it looks quite shallow now, but at high tide the water used to go over, so you could only ever cross at low tide. And that's why this like little bit of construction is part of modern day history for Tonga. Anyway, this is it. I'm gonna have a ride up and down it, because that is one of my favorite things to do on this island. And then a little bit of a chill out. I hope you enjoyed the brief history and culture lesson. Today in Hapai, I have come to Foa Island, which is in the north of Pangai, the main island, and those are both connected by a small road. And it's what you might call a paradise island. There are palm trees, there are white sandy beaches, turquoise coloured water that you can see behind me, and the most important thing, nobody else around. Absolutely nobody on this whole stretch of beach that stretches right down to the bottom tip of the island and then back onto Island. There are a couple of resorts up here, and the snorkeling is meant to be the best in Tonga. But not only snorkeling, there is also kite surfing, you can go horse riding on the beach. There is so many activities you can do up here. Unfortunately, all of those range a little bit out of my budget, but the snorkeling is something I have actually already tried out, and I can definitely say that it's some of the best snorkeling in Tonga, if not some of the best snorkeling that I've ever experienced in the world. So it's time to enjoy a little bit of paradise. I've got my book. I'm gonna chill out a little bit before I head back on that ferry back to Tongatapu this evening. As the sun sets, my time in sleepy Pangai is sadly coming to an end, and it's time to get ready for another 14 hours on this thing. I choose my bed under the stars tonight. I just hope it doesn't rain. I've made it back to the Tongatapu Island Group, and where I've been staying the past 2 or 3 months. So let's see where my next adventure will take me. Definitely need some coffee right now.